All right, so hello everyone and welcome to another vodcast by Mr. Mahan. As you can see at the top here, today's vodcast is going to have to do with formal charge. This is directly related to resonance, and so if you do not know how to do covalent bond resonance, you might kind of miss a little bit of the importance of this vodcast, and for that you might want to go back and look at the notes. But jumping right into what is formal charge and why do we care about it? So at least in AP for this year, 2017, we haven't discussed oxidation states yet, but we'll get into that and we'll talk about it. It's kind of like glorified charge, for the lack of better terms for now, but that's great for when we talk about ionically bonded species. It's even better for when we talk about what's really happening with electrons in covalently bonded compounds, which we'll probably get to in about a week or so from now. However, as oxidation states, as great as they are, they're not actually really pretty realistic, especially when we get into resonance type forms. And so we as a scientific community, we created this thing called the formal charge, because what it's going to do is it's going to allow us to compare how many actual valence shell electrons does an atom have prior to a covalently bonded or prior to forming a covalent bond. And then better yet, when it does actually join into a covalent bond, what kind of valence electrons is it going to have once it's within that actual molecule itself? And so here's the overall formula for formal charge. This is pretty important. And you're definitely going to want to write this down. So here's kind of more the why I like to get into. You necessarily need to know that? No, but you definitely need to know the formula. And so what we're going to do is we're going to build these molecules. We're going to analyze these covalently bonded compounds in terms of looking at these Lewis dot structures, whether it's resonating, whether it's not resonating. And then what we're going to do in order to analyze formal charge, we're going to take the number of valence electrons in the quote-unquote free state. So this would be like right off the periodic table. Okay, and I don't have my pen today, so I apologize. I'm using my mouse. But this is right what we're going to get off the periodic table, and then this is what we're going to get from the Lewis dot. All right, so this is what we're going to get once it's actually bonded. Ugh. And we're looking at the molecule itself after it's shared all of its electrons. Now, that's where the fun part comes in, because in the actual molecule, there's different types of electrons, right? There's lone pairs of electrons, and there are bonding pairs or shared pairs of electrons. So as we get into this part specifically, if and whenever we're talking about a molecule and it has its lone pairs, notice that, and you'll see in the future, that it's going to actually solely have and will take sole claim ownership over them. And the other thing to keep in mind, because again, there are shared pairs and there are lone pairs, is that if and when we are sharing electrons, remember that the whole point of sharing is that I'm going to put up one electron, you're going to put up another electron, and by sharing our two electrons together, we can actually create this covalent bond. So when we go to do the math, what we're actually going to do, and again, so all the way down here, here's how we're going to actually mathematically calculate this value right here, right? So the number of electrons in the free state, we're going to get straight from the periodic table, depending on the group it's in. But once we build the Lewis dot, the number of electrons in the molecule is actually going to be the summation as to the number of electrons in the lone pairs, plus I'm going to get half of the shared electrons or half of the shared pairs. Okay, so if I were to ask you to build the molecule of sulfate, SO4 with a 2-, you would put sulfur in the middle as it's the most needy. You would have put your four oxygens around it. You would have added up all your valence shell electrons, and those two X's are representing the extra two from the -2 that you can see up here. What you actually would have created is a beautiful little tetrahedral here. This all would have worked. Everybody would have had its 8. Okay, so if we break down the formal charge and we look at something like sulfate, right, what we're going to look at first is the oxygen. Okay, we're going to calculate the formal charge for the oxygen in this sulfate, in this version of sulfate. And since every oxygen is the same, all oxygens have a single bond to sulfur with three lone pairs around it, single bond 3, single bond 3, single bond 3, I'm going to do one calculation. So if I think about oxygen, if I were to find it on the periodic table, it's in group 16, right? 6 or 16. So we know that in its quote-unquote free state from the periodic table, it has 6 valence shell electrons. I know that if I actually look at the compound itself right here, every oxygen is the same, and every oxygen actually has 6 lone pairs along with 1 shared pair or 2 electrons within that shared pair. So it has 6 lone electrons, 3 lone pairs, and 2 shared electrons or 1 shared pair. So if I were to set up the overall equation, if I were to set up my formal charge, I would have taken the number from the periodic table, that's that 6, plus, or really minus, minus the amount of electrons it's assigned in the overall compound. Now, it's assigned 6 valence electrons, 6 lone electrons, plus half of this shared pair. And so half of 2 is 1. As you can see here, in the molecule, I have 6 lone electrons plus half of the bonding electrons. So I have a total of 6. So if I were to plug, or 7, sorry, 6 plus 1 is 7. So if I were to plug that into my formal charge equation, I have 6 minus 1. And so we would say that the formal charge of oxygen in this compound is a negative 1. If we were to then analyze sulfur, it too is in group 16. So it too is going to have 6 electrons in the free state. If I go and look at sulfur in this compound, the only electrons that sulfur has around it are shared electrons. It has 8 shared electrons, or 4 pairs of electrons. And so sulfur has 0 lone pairs around it in this compound, and it shares 8 with those different oxygens. So if I were to do a formal charge calculation for sulfur, again, I have the 0 plus half of 4. Those are the ones assigned to it in the compound. And I would then compare that to do the formal charge calculation. I would compare that to the 6 that it has off of the periodic table, aka in the free state. And so I would have 6 minus 4 is a plus 2. So the formal charge on oxygen in this compound is a negative 1. The formal charge on sulfur in this compound is a plus 2. Now again, at this point right now, these numbers mean absolutely nothing, but we're going to get to the good stuff now. We're going to get into what does this all mean right now. Okay, so why do we use formal charge? What's it used for? What the heck did we do that calculation for last time? And how is formal charge helpful? Well, believe it or not, this is another structure for sulfate. This is not a structure that I would expect anybody to really predict. We have sulfur actually breaking the octet rule here. We have sulfur actually with 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 electrons around it instead of the normal 8 we would expect. But watch what happens when we do a formal charge calculation here. So this time I actually have... All right, so here I just want to draw your attention to the fact that we do actually have 2 different oxygens in this case. In the previous one, we had 4 oxygens with a single bond and 6 lone electrons. Here we actually have 2 oxygens with single bonds and 6 lone, and then we have 2 oxygens with a double bond and 4 lone. So if I were to do the formal charge on the oxygen with the single bonds, just like what we had on the previous slide, I have 6 from the periodic table. I have the 6 valence electrons that are lone electrons. So this oxygen has claim to all 6 of these, plus half of the 2 that are in the bonding, aka half of 2 is 1. So 6 plus half of 2, so 6 plus 1 is 7, and we get that same negative 7 that we had last time. However, check out what happens when we look at the oxygen with double bonds. Oxygen still, according to the periodic table, would have 6 in the free state. Notice that we have actually a different number here instead of the 7. We actually have a 6 here, and where did that 6 come from? Well, this time, oxygen has 4 electrons, 4 lone electrons, 4 LEs, oh God, plus half of its bonding pairs. Well, it actually has 4 electrons now bonding, 4 electrons that are now sharing, and so half of 4 would be 2, and so 4 lone electrons plus the 2, or half of these 4, the 2, would give me my 6, and so that's where that 6 comes from, and that's where I plug that 6 in. So the formal charge for the oxygen with the single bond is still the negative 1 that we calculated on the previous slide, but now I have a different formal charge on my oxygens that actually have the double bonds, and so now I have a formal charge of 0 for some oxygens, a formal charge of negative 1 for oxygens, and better yet, watch what happens to the sulfur. Sulfur, it too ends up with a formal charge of 6, because it too has the 6 from the periodic table. And where did this 6 come from? Well, again, I have the total number of electrons that are lone, which is going to be 0. So for sulfur, I have 0 lone electrons, LEs, plus I have 1/2 of all of the electrons that are shared around it. And since I have 12 shared electrons, 1/2 of 12 is going to be 6. So 0 plus 1/2 of 12 is 6. And so that's where I get the 6 from. So what I notice here is that by changing the Lewis dot structure, by changing the believed structure of the compound, notice we get very different formal charges. So in the previous one, the one that we probably would have predicted where we had 4 single bonds, all with their own lone pairs, we had oxygen with a negative 1 and we had sulfur with a plus 2. Now we have an oxygen with a negative one, an oxygen with a zero, and a sulfur with a zero. Okay, so Mahan, what does this mean? What the heck is going on? Why do I care? All right, here we go. So these are the two biggies out of this slide. You got to know this, and you got to be able to digest this and hold on to this. So it turns out that, again, as we've been discussing a lot throughout the year, that there's a lot more than what meets the eye when these elements come in contact with each other and these bonds form. So it turns out that, again, electronegativity has something to play here. So if we are to believe that elements are constantly looking for stability and elements are constantly looking to lower their overall potential energy, then it makes sense that atoms in these molecules are trying to achieve their own same stability. And so therefore, it turns out that what formal charge really allows us to do is that if we understand the following things, atoms and molecules are always going to try and get as close to a formal charge of zero as possible. Because if we get a formal charge of zero, that means that I'm actually sharing or using as many electrons as I had to begin with. And so therefore, I've reached this overall very low, very solid, very stable potential energy value. So therefore, when we do these formal charges, we want as many of our atoms in the molecule to get to zero as possible. But if I can't get zeros for everybody, well, then the only elements that should end up with negative formal charges are those that are expected to reside or those that actually have the highest electronegativity. So if I go back and I look at structure one, this being structure one and this being structure two, as we just calculated in the previous slides, in structure one, each of these oxygens are the same, and we calculated that each of these oxygens would have had a formal charge of a negative one. It's actually not a big issue to begin with because oxygen is very electronegative. However, the flip side to that is that sulfur, something else that's very electronegative, it's going to have a formal charge of a plus two, which is really, really bad. We really don't want anything to have a positive formal charge, let alone something as electronegative like sulfur. If we were to analyze structure two, as we just did on the last one, we have those two oxygens that are within the double bonds that actually have a formal charge of zero. We had two oxygens that had a formal charge of negative one, and we also even had that sulfur to be a negative zero. So what does all that mean, and why do we care about all that? Well, what this actually tells us, what it tells us is that as crazy as this compound is and as weird looking as this compound might be, and even though this breaks the octet rule for sulfur, sulfur is actually happier. It actually has a lower formal charge and therefore a lower potential energy if it's actually forced to break the octet rule rather than what we would normally expect sulfur to do. So what formal charge allows us to do is to analyze these provided, and you will have provided in class these crazy, wacky looking what we would expect a molecule to do versus what we would not expect it to do. But what formal charge really allows us to do is to look at different resonance structures, and some of which that really make absolutely no sense at all, but to look at different resonance structures and then therefore apply these two rules to the resonance structures in order to identify which structure is actually preferred, which structure actually has lower potential energy, and therefore which structure truly represents the way that the molecules or the atoms actually bond when these molecules are formed. I know that right now this still might be like, what is going on? And that's okay. We're going to practice more of these in class, but at least now you've looked at formal charge. And if nothing else, you understand, or hopefully, if nothing else, you remember that formal charge, FC, the formula for it is the number of electrons from the periodic table in the free state minus the number of electrons within the molecule itself. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.